How are you?
I'm okay. I have two screens. One will be for my phone, because a lot of times there's a delay on my home internet.
Okay, so I'll
just need to be able to share on my screen. So what you're seeing from me is my phone.
Okay, so I'm gonna
make your
computer on as well.
Okay.
And then I'll write you a message in the chat when you have 3 minutes left.
Sure, not a problem. Okay, share screen. Give me a second. Okay, so Ilana, I'm assuming you see the PowerPoint?
Yeah, okay. I see.
And you see me with the other my phone, internet, correct? Perfect.
Yeah.
Should I start now?
Yeah, let me just check that we're all set. Okay, great. So next year we'll be hearing from David Nekrutman on the topic of Between Rachel and Leah, the Book of Ruth. So thank you very much and take it away.
Good morning, our Torah Stone family. It's a pleasure to give you the word of Torah from Zion and fulfilling this prophecy today. Also want to wish Rabbi Riskin a happy birthday. Chazak Yamatz. I want to thank Rabbi Riskin personally for almost 13 years ago. We established the Center for Jewish Christian Understanding and Cooperation. I've been involved in Jewish Christian relations for almost 19 years. But that unbelievable encounter in November of 2007, meeting Rabbi Riskin at Ben Gurion Airport and discussing the future of Jewish Christian relations and opening up the first institutional response from Israel in advancing Jewish Christian relations today. I also want to thank Rabbi Kenneth Brander, who's continued to advance this relationship we see today unfolding before our eyes. Before I begin into the topic itself of the connection between Rachel and Leah and the Book of Ruth, I want to begin with a short teaser. Just want to make sure I'm able to move my... See, give me a second. I'm having some technical difficulty here. Ilana? Ah, there we go. Okay, perfect. In Mishlei, in Proverbs chapter 8, verse 30, it says, I was in Ammon, this is the Hebrew term, beside him. I was his delight every day, playing before him at all times. In this chapter in Proverbs, we have the Torah describing its relationship to God as an Ammon. The question is, what is the translation of Ammon? So if we look at Tanakh and we look around at different places, we'll see that it either means nursing, covered, raised, or great. But most translations actually use some type of artisan translation. And this is a rabbinical interpretation to the understanding of the Hebrew word Ammon, either as an architect or a master craftsman. So the Torah is describing its relationship to God as an architect and a master craftsman. And most translators use this translation in describing the understanding of the relationship of the Torah to God. And the question is where did the Chachamim, where did the rabbis mine this revelation of understanding the relationship between the Torah and Hashem as one, as an artisan? So this really pertains to our celebration of Shavuot, where we have Matan Torah, the Sinaitic revelation. And it begins, I am the eternal, your God, who brought you out from the land of Egypt, from the house of slavery. And obviously those people who are familiar with Hebrew will know that the beginning of what's normally as the chapter heading called the Ten Commandments, or we would say the Aseret Dibrot, the 10 categories of understanding what God wants from us, it begins with an alternative expression for the word I. I in Hebrew is usually ani. Here in the introduction, or possibly the first mandate of the ten commandments, is anochi. And if we believe that Hashem's language in the Torah is exact, then every single letter and every single word has meaning. There's no redundancy. And therefore, why are we using an alternative expression to the word I? And there's many, many, many different interpretations to understanding this question. And one of them really pertains to what we're dealing with today. Ana nafshi ketavi havi. In fact, Anochi is an acronym, just similar to, let's say, Amen. Many people believe Amen is a translation of so be it or verily, but Amen is an acronym of El Melech Neman, God is a faithful king. So that three-letter acronym is a kingdom response, an Ol Malchut Shemayim response to what's going on in the context of whatever the bracha, the blessing, is being given. Here in the introduction of the Sinaitic revelation of Matan Torah, God is saying very much poetically, my soul is inscribed in the words that I gave you. So what we're doing right now this morning is engaging in God's soul, so to speak. My hope is that whatever nugget I give to you to understanding the relationship between the Book of Ruth and the relationship between Rachel and Leah will advance our journey with Hashem, will also enhance our sweet tooth for God's word, for the Torah. We begin with Ruth chapter 4, verse 11. And all the people who were in the gate, and the elders reply, we are witnesses. May the Eternal make the woman who is entering into your house like Rachel and like Leah, both of whom built up the house of Israel, and prosper in Ephrath and be famous in Bethlehem and Bethlehem. So we're here at a Levirate like marriage. It's not exactly like a Levirate marriage. We know that a Levirate marriage is done by the brother, but here it's not a brother. So it's a Levirate like marriage. We have the people gathering and witnessing the ceremony, and they're giving a blessing over to Ruth that she should be like Rachel and Leah. And the question is this not an E! True Hollywood story? Rachel and Leah and Jacob, a love triangle. If we do a peripheral reading of the Bible, do we really want to give the blessing of Rachel and Leah to Ruth? It seems like if you do a first glance reading of the text and understanding the relationship between Rachel and Jacob, Rachel and Leah, Leah and Rachel, and Leah and Jacob, it just seems like a love triangle, jealousy, competition. If I would come up with one word to describe the scenario between Rachel and Leah and Jacob, and yet we want to provide a blessing as a model of what is your life should be with HaKadosh Baruch Hu, with Hashem, like in the context of Rachel and Leah, I mean, what is really going on? Like what Seinfeld would say, really, is this what we're doing? And let's amplify this a little bit. If we look at how Leah names her children, it even brings out the jealousy even more, or Leah's wanting of love from Jacob. In naming Reuben, naming Reuven in Genesis chapter 29, verse 18, it's in the context, and Jacob, and the Eternal saw that Leah was hated, and Jacob loved Rachel. So let me just do that over again. We look at the relationship between Jacob and Leah, and Jacob and Rachel in the context of a love triangle. It's a little bit more complicated than that, because in Genesis chapter 29, verse 18, Jacob loved Rachel. But if we go to verse 31, we see that Hashem sees something different. It's not that he loved Rachel more than Leah. He sees that Leah is hated. And this will come out in the naming of the children in Genesis chapter 29, verse 32, in the naming of Reuven, for now my husband will love me. In the naming of Simeon, of Shimon, since the Lord has heard that I am hated, he gave me this one too. In the naming of Levi, now this time my husband will be attached to me. So here are verses describing the complicated relationship between these two sisters and Jacob. However, the question comes up is how do we really make the connection between Rachel and Leah and Ruth? So we're going to come back in a second to that slide that I just showed you. But I want to go back to the verse itself. The Eternal make the woman who is entering into your house like Rachel and like Leah, both who built up the house of Israel. So if you look at that word in Hebrew, shitehem, and if you understand anything with Hebrew, there should be fire coming out of your ears, bells ringing in your mind, because if you use the word shitehem in reference to females, it's wrong grammatically. It's not a grammatically correct word. It should be shitehen. We have a fusion of a male and a female word. And because it's unusual to have a word like this in reference and describing a relationship between two women, therefore we can mine the revelation of what the Torah is trying to tell us and what's the connection of all of this. Because of Shittehem. The question is where does this word appear in the Bible again? And it appears only in Ruth. So we only have the word Shittehem twice in Tanakh, both in Ruth. We just saw one appearance of it in chapter 4, verse 11. And now we have in reference to Naomi and Ruth coming to Israel. And that word Shittehem appears. So simply by the Hebrew word association that only appears twice in the Bible, we know there is a connection. Now we have to unravel the mystery of what this connection really is. So the first is an approach, a Talmudic Midrashic approach to understanding this relationship of Rachel and Leah and how this all fits into the blessing to Ruth. The opening scene of when Jacob meets Rachel is in Genesis chapter 29. And it came to pass when Jacob saw Rachel, the daughter of Laban, his mother's brother, and the sheep of Laban, his mother's brother, that Jacob drew near and rolled the rock off the mouth of the well, and he watered the sheep of Laban, his mother's brother. And Jacob kissed Rachel, and he raised his voice, and he wept. Midrash says the reason why Jacob wept was because he saw one day he would not be buried with his wife. But here's the kicker of understanding the beginnings of this complicated relationship between Rachel and Leah and Rachel and Jacob, here specifically with Jacob and Rachel. And Jacob told Rachel that he was her father's brother and that he was Rebekah's son. And you should just stop in your tracks for one moment because Jacob is not the brother of Rachel's father.
David, I'm going to pause you. I see that someone's raising their hand.
Sure.
Ursula, do you have a question? Ursula?
Do we have a question?
Maybe it was an accident. All right, go ahead.
All right, okay. So the identification of the relationship as far as Laban to Jacob seems to be not correct. So the Midrash is going to hone into that, and I'm going to skip over to the end of this story where there is a switch of sisters on the supposed wedding night, and Jacob wakes up in the morning, and it came into pass the morning, and behold, she was Leah. Now, if you go through this entire episode of what's going on, obviously Leah was there the entire night, and we can say this verse differently. If I was the editor of this verse, and in the morning, Leah was there, pretty much. Why behold she was Leah? Like Leah wasn't there the entire time? So the Midrash is going, Midrash and the Talmud are going to hone in on these two verses to provide an explanation to what the relationship is truly about. So the first we go to the Talmud and Bava Batra, page 123, side A. And what was a demonstration of the modesty that Rachel possessed? As it's written, and Jacob told Rachel that he was her father's brother and that he was Rebekah's son. The Talmud asks, but isn't he the son of her father's sister? Why did he say that he was his father's brother? Rather, Jacob and Rachel had the following exchange. Jacob said to Rachel, will you marry me? And Rachel said to him, yes, but my father is a deceitful person and you cannot defeat him. And Jacob said to her, what is his method of deceit of which I need to be aware? And Rachel said to him, I have a sister who is older than me. He will not marry me off before he marries her off, even if he promises that he will do so. And Jacob said to her, I am his brother, meaning equal in deceit. He will not be able to outwit me. And this is why Jacob said that he was her father's brother. So the relationship that Jacob's identifying with Laban is one of, if he's going to try to outwit me, I will outwit him. And then Rachel, a little shocked by what Jacob is saying, is it permitted for the righteous to act deceitfully? And Jacob is basically saying at the end, it depends upon the circumstance. And Jacob and Rachel give secret signs to prove to him that at the wedding night, it would be Rachel and no one else. So we, according to the Talmud at this point in time, in the unfolding of this exciting saga in the Bible, that will have monumental ramifications in building up the house of Israel, we see that already Rachel and Jacob are in love, they want to marry each other, and they're providing the signs to be exchanged during the wedding night so nothing goes wrong and Laban will not win. However, in the tractate Megillah, the Talmud in Megillah, page 13b, there's a lot that is given over about this episode, in fact, repeating what happened in the Talmud and Bava Batra. However, there's an added caveat. So when the wedding night arrived and Laban planned to switch the sisters, Rachel said to herself, "Ooh, now my sister will be embarrassed, for Jacob will ask her for the signs and she will not know them." So she gave them to her, as it's written, "It came to pass in the morning, behold, it was Leah." Does this imply by inference that until now she was not Leah? Rather, due to the distinguishing signs that Rachel had given to Leah, he did not know until now, when it was light outside, that she was Leah. Therefore, Rachel merited that Saul may descend from her due to her act of modesty and not revealing to Jacob that she has shown the signs to Leah. So, and a moment before the wedding night was happening, Rachel realizes that Leah will be disgraced. To avoid that disgrace and embarrassment, she gives up marrying Jacob and gives her gives Leah the signs to pose as Rachel during the wedding night for Jacob. So unlike the peripheral reading that we see that there's jealousy and competition between the two sisters in the Talmudic understanding thus far, it's really compassion and trying not to embarrass one another. And actually selflessness happening here with Rachel in understanding the circumstance with Leah. So it's not one of jealousy, it's one of commitment to the sister. Now, we could just stop there and understand this relationship to be very, very important as far as two sisters working together. But a Midrash in Lamentations Rabbah gives us a real, real kicker to the story. Not only did she share the signs, whatever those signs were, Rachel literally was in the bedroom of the wedding night between Leah and Jacob. She was hiding under the bed. And when Jacob would say something to Leah, Rachel was the one who would be with the voice. And therefore, we would understand why in the morning, behold, the shock that it was Leah. The Midrash is amplifying that literally in the room was Rachel and helping Leah through this entire wedding evening. So in this context of Lamentations Rabbah, I'm just giving you a little glimpse of the text in that Midrash. But the context of this Midrash is really a lot of people like Moses and Abraham are trying to intercede on behalf of the Jewish people to have them return from exile back to the land of Israel. And the only one who is able to convince God to bring the children back to Israel is Rachel, because of what she did, of the kindness she did to her sister, that she wouldn't be led into a moment of disgrace with Jacob. Now, the question is, what was there ever a conversation that Jacob had with Leah, and what was it? And so the Midrash provides context for that as well. So all that night he would call her Rachel, and she answered him. Now, in the context of the other Midrash, we understand who's answering. It's really Rachel. So in the morning, behold, it was Leah. And he said, "How can you have deceived me, you daughter of a deceiver?" So this is Jacob to Leah. "You're a daughter of a deceiver." She said to him, "Is there a teacher without faithful students? Didn't your father call you Esau, and you answered him accordingly? So you called me by another name, and I answered you." So what's interesting about this Midrash is that there is a conversation that takes place between Jacob and Leah. Leah knows about what Jacob did in stealing the blessings from Esau, and did it under the guise of posing as Esau. And what the Midrash is pointing out is something called Mida Keneged Mida. What comes around, comes around. This is not the Justin Timberlake song. It's just simply the concept of someone intentionally doing something and the consequences that come out from that. A lot of times we're talking about things that are negative in nature, but Mida Keneged Mida in Jewish understanding of this concept can also be for positive stuff. But in the context of what we're dealing with here is that Jacob deceived his father, and what ends up happening to him is he's being deceived. So what comes around, Mida Keneged Mida. This will all provide an understanding of what the blessing of Rachel and Leah is to Ruth from a Midrashic Talmudic perspective. That the relationship between Rachel and Leah is one of compassion, working together to build the house of Israel. It is not one of jealousy and competition. But the problem is that at the end, they did hurt Jacob and did deceive Jacob. And the beginnings of building up the house of Israel was one done in deception. Ruth comes along, and here's Ruth. Ruth leaves her God behind, leaves her homeland and her house behind to take on the faith of the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and to attach herself to Knesset Yisrael, to the Jewish nation. And if you pay attention to chapter 3 of the book of Ruth, you will know that in the darkness of night, she wanted to consummate the union of a Levirate-like marriage. And Boaz decides and not to do that, that there's someone's closer to redeeming Ruth than he is. But in the fourth chapter, it is done in the open, not in secret, not done in deception. Everyone knows what's going on. And in fact, all the elders are agreeing to this moment and then giving over the blessing. So Ruth is looked upon as a tikkun, a corrective measure in the history of the Jewish nation. What began in deceit now is being corrected by Ruth, and she is rewarded with royalty and messiahship. So from her comes King David, Solomon, and one day Mashiach will be coming soon. And now we'll give you a pshat redemptive perspective on understanding this text. In the pshat understanding of it, I will concentrate where we begin with the blue. And Jacob loved Rachel, and he said, I will work for you 7 years for Rachel, your younger daughter. And Laban said, it is better that I give her to you than I should give her to another man. So it's important to understand that when Jacob is working out this deal with Laban, he's specifically saying Rachel and younger daughter. When Laban is responding, he's not saying anyone's name. So Jacob worked for Rachel 7 years, but they appeared to him like a few days before because of his love for her. And now Jacob said to Laban, give me my wife, for my days are completed that I may come to her. So again, Jacob is never going to Rachel. We don't have any canonized text that there was a conversation between Jacob and Rachel. It's always a conversation between Jacob and Laban. So what does Laban do? He gathers all the people of the place. He made a feast, and it came to pass in the evening, and Laban took his daughter Leah, and he brought her to him, and he came, and they had an intimate moment. And Laban gave Zilpah, his maidservant, to his daughter Leah as a maidservant. And it came to pass in the morning, behold, she was Leah. So right now, the first conversation you probably would have was with Leah, but what we have in the text is he goes to Laban, what is this that you have done to me? Did I not work with you for Rachel? Why have you deceived me? So 5 things we can take away from the text. Number 1, Jacob and Laban make the transaction. There's no recorded canonized text indicating any conversation with Rachel or Leah. It's not like that Rachel and Leah knew they were going to get married to Jacob. This is not like the Talmudic Midrashic understanding of the relationship and what took place. If you look at the canonized text in and of itself, then we don't have any conversation. Only the one that we have, we don't have, we just simply don't have. And who makes the party? Laban makes the party, but it's not necessarily, it's a wedding. Because if it was a wedding, there should be details a little bit about the wedding. And proof of it is Laban is bringing Leah at night after the party. It should be the husband bringing the bride back home. So why is Laban bringing Leah? And if you're at a party, and it seems like a party of basically the contract is being fulfilled right now, Jacob is drunk. So that's how he was able to be deceived. The thing here is that Rachel and Leah are commodities, and the negotiators are Laban and Jacob. But in Genesis chapter 30, verses 14 through 16, we see a complete transformation of who will be the negotiators and who's going to be the commodity. And this is in the text of the Dudaim. Reuben went in the days of the wheat harvest, and he found Dudaim in the field, and he brought them to Leah, his mother. And Rachel said to Leah, "Now give me some of your son's Dudaim." And she said to her, "This is now Leah to Rachel. Is it a small matter that you have taken my husband, that you wish to also take my son's Dudaim?" So the rest of the verses is basically a negotiation thing. And at the end, Leah has an intimate evening with Jacob. The point of it is that if I was Rachel, I would have responded back to Leah, "I stole your husband, you stole my husband." If there was a commitment made and everyone knew what was going on, that Jacob would be first marrying Rachel, then Rachel's automatic response shouldn't be to work out this transaction. It should be one that says, "I didn't steal your husband. In fact, Leah, you stole my husband." So I believe my from a textual shot point of view, a simple understanding of the text of itself, they simply never knew who was going to marry Jacob. Now, also in that text, you're going to see a sort of amplification. They were the ones negotiating who's going to spend a night with Jacob. Jacob is really now the commodity in that. Jacob continues to be the one who's passive. And in fact, when he wants to leave Laban, he goes to Rachel and Leah in Genesis chapter 1, verses 14 through 16. And they say, "Do we still have a share or an inheritance in our father's house? Are we not considered by him as strangers? For he sold us and consumed our money. But all the wealth that God separated from our father is ours and our children's. So now all that God said to you, do." So Rachel and Leah are now in charge, and Jacob is listening. So if you want to understand Shittehem, this makes sense. Normally, they were the ones who took a male role, normally defined as a male role, in building up the house of Israel. So the same thing here with Ruth. Ruth is taking on the sort of the male role of building up her house that affects Am Yisrael, affects the nation of Israel eventually. So what is in common between Rachel and Leah is that they are from a different God, from a different homeland. They leave everything behind, similar to Ruth, who once believed in a different God and came from a different homeland. They leave everything to marry somebody from the Jewish nation, to build up. So Rachel and Leah took active approach to building up the house of Jacob. I will even say further, just from a text point of view, that the maidservants were also part of building up the house of Israel. And if we have any precedent that maidservants usually don't work out in the Bible, you just go look in the book of Genesis in itself, and you will see that it didn't work out with Hagar when Sarah recommended Hagar to have children with Abraham. But Bilhah and Zilpah are all part of the process of building up Israel. So you see their active role. And what the blessing is at the end, from a shot point of view, from the context of Shittehem, is that we want Ruth, we're saying to Ruth, continue to build up the house of Israel. But now let's do this out in the open, and everyone knows. And because of what Ruth did, the rest is history, and history in the making. Okay, Ilana. I realize I have 2 minutes left. Is there any questions I need to answer before the next?
First of all, thank you very much for the very interesting and thought-provoking shiur. I see so far one question, but it's in Spanish. I don't know.
Okay. Ilana doesn't know Spanish. Okay.
Otherwise, if someone else has a question, you're welcome to write it in the chat or raise your hand on the Zoom and I can open your microphone.
So if that's it, I just want to say and give an opportunity to say thank you to everybody who's listening And again, once again, to Or Torah Stone, to be part of this wonderful family, people dedicated to Am Yisrael, to spreading the Torah to the world, to all the people who made this 24-hour happy birthday to Rabbi Riskin, and to also celebrate the upcoming holiday of Shavuot this evening. Everyone should have a Chag Kasher V'Sameach, and greetings and blessings from Israel.
Beautiful. Thank you so much, and have a Chag Sameach.
Take care.
Bye-bye.